It's great to see everybody out this morning. We're glad you're here. It feels like a lively bunch this morning. I don't know, there seems to be a lot of life in the crowd. I hope you're feeling good and you're ready to worship. It's a beautiful day outside. We've had a beautiful week. I think everybody's excited about spring. And of course, you know, that's when the world that God created kind of comes alive, isn't it? Would you stand with us this morning? We're going to worship God this morning in song. We hope you'll really sing out. Let's really lift our praises up to the Lord this morning.
Seated for your missions moment.
Brother Nathan's going to click through some slides there for us this morning from our recent trip to Saltillo. Steve Treep, Ed Lockard, and I just returned from a one-week mission trip to Saltillo, Mexico on Wednesday night. Our trip was successful and we accomplished our goal of pouring a concrete roof on a second floor of a Church of Christ building in Saltillo. This is the place where Alfonso Alvarez is the located preacher, and we want to thank all of you for your prayers and for your financial support for this mission trip. We had enough money to not only pour the concrete roof, but also to complete the building with windows, doors, and stairs to the second floor. So hopefully the building will be completed in the near future. Our trip began on Wednesday afternoon, March the 9th, but when we got to Houston, a terrible rainstorm delayed many flights and canceled our trip to Monterey. So we had to spend the night in a Houston hotel and didn't get to Saltillo until Thursday afternoon. And our suitcases did not arrive until Friday afternoon. So all we had was what we had on, and what we had packed in our carry-on luggage, which wasn't much. And Thursday and Friday in Saltillo, it was very cold and very windy. And I was prepared for that because I had packed two hooded sweatshirts, which were, of course, in my suitcase back in Houston. Snow covered the mountains all around Saltillo. But we worked through the day on Friday in the cold and the wind with temperatures in the 40s and 50s. But by Friday evening, the roof was ready for concrete. About seven or eight Mexican men helped pour the concrete roof on Saturday, with Steve Treep working with them all day long without even eating lunch. I was on the roof helping in the morning when Alfonso asked Ed Lockard and me to go with him to the poor colony on the outskirts of the city where they have a mission church that... The Church of Christ is the only religious organization doing anything to help the people there. And every Saturday, the church meets there and has Bible classes for all ages, three classes for the children, and the adults meet inside the building. And they also, after getting their spiritual food, they have a simple physical meal. And that day it was rice and mole, which is brown chicken with brown gravy. And there were about 37 children there that day and 12 adults. And since the church has been established in that part of the city, on the outskirts of the town, I think four people have been baptized into Christ. And it is the poorest community I've ever worked in, and I've worked in some pretty poor places, but this was the poorest. The people have dirt floors, no running water. The electricity is a line running across the ground. We were there last year giving out reading glasses as well as in several other locations in and around Saltillo. On Sunday, we watched your service on my iPhone, this little device right here, and through the live stream internet link that we provide every Sunday, and it does go around the world on the internet. Then our church service in Saltillo began at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, lasted till about 3 o'clock Mexican time, give or take a 30 minutes there. And after the service was over, we had a fellowship dinner with the church, and the food was good. It was better on Sunday than it was on Saturday. And we supplied the dessert. The dessert was candy and suckers from the Pikeville Walmart. So it was very good to be with Clinton and Alicia Looney once again and to hear him preach both Saturday and Sunday, with him actually translating into English on Sunday for our benefit. I was asked to pray for the sick that last Sunday, including a little boy named Santiago, which in English means James. He's 4 years old and he has cancer. I continue to pray for him and ask that you pray for him as well, and also for his mother, who is not a Christian. I know she's not a Christian because I was asked to serve the Lord's Supper to the entire congregation, and I knew who to serve because the Christians were standing. Everyone else was seated. And that was the first time I ever did that, and it was an honor. On Monday, we worked on some doors at both locations, and we also came across a line of people in the poor colony, near the poor colony of Morales, who were lined up there to receive free food from the government. It was the same day we gave out food here on Monday morning, our Hope Day. And by the way, we've got more Hope food left over to give out, if you know of someone who needs it. On Tuesday, we went to the Desert Museum in Saltillo, which was very interesting, very enjoyable. And then we rode back to Monterey to be there for a 6 a.m. or 6:30 flight back to Houston on Wednesday morning. We arrived back in Louisville at 7 p.m. Wednesday night, and all of our luggage traveled safely with us that time. So thank you again for your prayers. God was with us every mile of the way, and keep praying.
Thank you, Jerry. We're going to continue worshiping in song right now. Would you stand with us again, please?
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. His cornerstone is solid ground. Fiercest driving storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace. When fears are still with striving seas. My comforter, my all in all. Here in the love of Christ I stand. God in heaven stands. Man can never find me found his end till he returns.
words were not on the screen there. I was stumbling through the words, and because I can't remember that stuff, and not an errand. So I was imagining what it was like to be up here without this paper in front of me. I used to write these things out, and then I got up here and couldn't read a word of them. So now I started typing them, so I could figure out what I was saying here. I have a little article I found in a paper quite a few months back, and I put it aside, and because I didn't want to, some of the words were trying to pronounce them was really hard. I title this Condescension. I start to say condensation. Condescension that brought redemption. Condescension, a word we never use, never will use. But I looked this up in my Webster dictionary. I actually use or still use a dictionary. My youngest son will say, why don't you Google that? I don't Google things much, but here's the definition. Condescension, to put aside one's dignity or superiority voluntarily and assume equality with one regarded as inferior. They knew that that is? That's us, humans. We're very inferior, lowly humans. In Philippians, we read, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant. Being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by being obedient to death, even death on a cross. Communion is an incredible story of condescension. Did I get that word right? The Christ and the Son of the living God, the creator of this universe. And to me, when I pray, and most of you, heard Steve say that, when you pray, I always pray to our creator. I thank God for creating it. And I know he owns it all, and he's the creator of of this universe. He condescended to a lowly manger, then an old rugged cross on a hill. It never happened before, and it will never happen again. When we break the bread this morning and drink the cup, we are kind of enacting the greatest love story ever. This is it right here. In Romans, they write, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. In this section here, read a word of it, because no king, queen, president, prime minister, chancellor, czar, sultan, or sovereign would ever condescend to do what Jesus did for you on Calvary. Nobody. You can think about that. The creator of the universe stepped down to earth that we might step up to heaven. He entered himself that we might be full. He died on a cross that we could live in a mansion. And then, sir, this little poem here, three verses, four, I want to read. Said, what condescension, bringing us redemption, that in the dead of night, not one faint hope in sight, God, gracious, tender, laid aside his splendor. He laid aside his splendor. No one has ever loved you so much that they would die for you. Sometimes you say, the parents will say, I would die for my child. We probably would. That's true, maybe, for that. But he made atonement for our sins. Remember this today as you partake of these emblems. And it ended with this one thing. As the cup and loaf were passed this morning, remember, say this to yourself. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. No one ever cared for me like Jesus.
He's given Jesus Christ his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ his Son. And now let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich.
us pray. O Lord our God, we come to you this morning as humble as we know how. We thank you, Lord, for your life. We thank you for your death, dear God, that paved the way for our eternal life. So, Lord, this morning as we meet around your table, I would pray that you would bless this loaf that represents that body that was broken upon Calvary. And I pray, Lord, that you'll bless each of us as we partake. Help us, Father, that our faith might be strengthened. Lord, that we might see Jesus in observing of this Lord's Supper. For it's in Jesus' name that I pray.
Our Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you again for this beautiful Lord's Day. We just thank you for each person that's present here this morning to fellowship with one another, to honor you, Father, and praise your holy name. Father, we thank you for the love that you have for us, and Father, we love you, but Father, how great our love is not compared to the love that you have for us. Father, we thank you for blessing this congregation another year, another Easter coming up on us, and Father, just help us to focus this week on the suffering and tormenting death that Jesus suffered at the cross, his burial, his resurrection. Lord, we know there's no greater historical event than the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Father, we thank you so much for him. We know you gave us your only son. Father, as we gather around this table today, we gather to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for us and to proclaim his death until he comes again. And Father, we know there's many in our family and those that we know and those around the world that are not Christians today. And we just pray that, Lord, they'd accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior and the sacrifice that he made for each and every one. The sacrifice was good once and for all, everyone. And Father, we thank you for this cup today that represents the precious blood that was shed there at Calvary's cross. And we just ask your blessings to be upon each and every one of us as we partake together. For it's in Jesus' loving name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
song we're going to sing for special this morning is a song we're going to try to do in the future for our worship service, but we thought we would introduce it to you this morning as a special. And it talks about, it's by Chris Tomlin, it's called At the Cross, Lover in Red. Some of you may know this song, but it talks about there's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. And the words will be on the screen. If you want to sing along with us, we'd be more than happy for you to sing along with us this morning.
At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in.
surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus. Jesus.
Our last series of messages was on the subject, "The Bible Doesn't Say That," and today we're going to begin a new series on what the Bible does say on fundamentals of the faith. Today's message is the Word of God on baptism, and our text comes from Matthew chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. And John tried to prevent him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and are you coming to me?" But Jesus answered and said to him, "Permit it to be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." And then he allowed him. When he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water. And behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. And suddenly a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Let's pray. Thank you, God, that we're assembled today in your presence. Thank you, God, for blessing us with the opportunity to worship you here in this place at this time at Coal Run this morning. We praise you, God, because you're worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our time, our treasure, our talent, our all. Because without you, we are nothing. We would have nothing. We would be of all men most miserable without Jesus Christ as our Savior, without the hope we have in him. And through his death, burial, and resurrection, the good news of the gospel saving us, giving us life abundant, life eternal. Thank you. Thank you, Father, for Jesus. Thank you for saving us through your plan of redemption. And I pray that as your plan from your word goes out today, that it will fall on receptive hearts and minds, and that people will believe it enough to obey it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Almost every church in the world that claims to have anything to do with Jesus Christ practices baptism in some form or fashion. Some sprinkle or pour water on a person's head and call that baptism, while others immerse totally under the water. Some perform baptism on infants, while others wait until a person is old enough to decide for himself to be baptized. Some believe it comes before salvation. Some believe it comes after some salvation. And many believe that it is the very point and place where God saves us. And so, something that should be so easily understood has become profoundly misunderstood. Something that should produce unity among believers has led to the division of many of those who claim to follow Jesus Christ. I think about children sometimes who have trouble even pronouncing the word. And they call it, have you ever heard it called baptism? We smile when a child comes up to us and say, "I want to be baptized." One time a child at the Van Sant Church of Christ was asking a question about the baptistry. We were cleaning the building that particular night, and an elder's wife said, "Well, that's where people have their sins washed away." And the little boy came up and he says, "Let me see those sins." And of course,
He couldn't see them because they were indeed washed away. But sometimes the Church of Christ is accused of teaching water salvation or water regeneration, as if we teach that the act of baptism is the only thing involved in our salvation. And of course, that has never been true, but it has always been true that Bible baptism is for the purpose of the forgiveness of sins. Amen. But let me share with you two common views about baptism that are both wrong. First of all, the view that baptism is important but not necessary. People who say this would never say that faith or repentance is not necessary, but most Protestant denominations do say baptism is not necessary. And yet the Bible says, believe and be baptized, repent and be baptized. And yet many denominations place baptism after salvation. How many times have you and I heard the statement, I got saved and got baptized? I got saved and got baptized. It is said that way because they consider it two different things. Getting saved is one thing, and getting baptized is something that comes later, because that is what they have been taught all their life. But the Bible teaches baptism, when preceded by genuine faith and repentance, is the very place and time where we are saved. But another common view that is also wrong is that baptism is necessary because faith is not enough. In other words, some people view baptism as a work that we do in addition to believing in Jesus for salvation. But baptism is never called a work in the Bible. Baptism is an act of faith. It is an expression of faith, just like repentance or confession are expressions of faith. Baptism is not a work of man. It is a work being to you by God Himself. Paul put it this way in Colossians 2:12, buried with Him in baptism, in which you also were raised with Him through faith. Through faith in the working of God, who raised Him from the dead. This verse makes it clear that baptism, first of all, is a burial and not a sprinkling. And it also makes it clear that God is the one doing the work, not the person being baptized. The very next verse says, He has made alive together with Him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Which makes it clear that baptism is to forgive you of your trespasses and allows a person to have a new life in Christ. We're made alive in Him. But what exactly did Jesus say and do concerning this topic? The very first mention of baptism in the Bible is in our text that we read this morning, Matthew 3, where John is baptizing people in the Jordan River, and John's ministry was to prepare the way for Jesus Christ and for the kingdom that Jesus was about to establish on the earth, the kingdom of God or the church of Christ. He was baptizing people in the Jordan River because it took much water to immerse people and to follow the way of baptism and what the word means, which means plunge, dip, or immerse. And Mark 1 verse 4 says that John's baptism was a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. It was the will of God for people in that time and place to be baptized by John's baptism. Luke 7 and verse 30 says, But the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the will of God for themselves, not having been baptized by Him. So Jesus walks 65 miles about from Galilee to the Jordan River, where His cousin John is baptizing people in Judea. Jesus is about to begin His public ministry. And so Jesus comes to be baptized. But Jesus didn't have any sins to forgive. And John the Baptist knew it. And he said, I need to be baptized by you. But Jesus said, permit it to be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. In other words, being baptized was the right thing to do. And the only reason Jesus was not baptized to forgive his sins was simply the fact because he had no sins to forgive. He was perfect. But Jesus was setting an example. He was setting an example of obedience for everyone who would follow him. So this is how Jesus began his public ministry. And now let's go to the last chapter of the Gospel of Matthew and see how Jesus ends his public ministry. Just before he ascended back to his Father in heaven, Jesus told his disciples, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." And so Jesus began his public ministry by walking 65 miles to be baptized. Jesus ends his earthly ministry by telling his disciples to make more disciples by baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So think about this. If baptism wasn't necessary, why was Jesus baptized? Especially since he was sinless. And if baptism wasn't necessary, why did he tell his disciples to baptize those who want to be disciples of his? Now, these are fair questions, and our denominational friends do not have good answers. They just appeal to the thief on the cross who lived and died under the Old Testament law of Moses and was forgiven by Jesus himself under the Old Testament dispensation of time. Before Jesus' death on the cross. That's when the thief on the cross was saved. And that, my friends, is a very poor argument to say that people living on this side of the cross, on this side of the Great Commission, on this side of the day of Pentecost, living under the authority of the New Testament, to say you do not have to be baptized to be saved. That is not what Jesus taught. In fact, Jesus taught the exact opposite. And so if Jesus did it, and if Jesus told us to do it, why would anyone say, you don't have to do it? But it's being preached right now in some pulpit in this country and around the world. Look at what Jesus said in Mark 16, 15, and 16. He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. He who does not believe will be condemned. So what did Jesus say to preach? He said to preach the gospel, which is the good news. The good news of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is what saves us. Most all churches teach that. But how does the gospel save us? Just believing it? Or believing it enough to obey it? Jesus said, he who believes and is baptized will be saved. Many people look at the last phrase of verse 16 and say, if you believe, you are not condemned. Because the Bible does say, he who does not believe will be condemned. So it's obvious to every rational reader of the Bible that non-believers will not be baptized and will not be saved. If you don't believe, you won't be baptized in the Bible way for the Bible reason. To be condemned, there's only one requirement necessary. Don't believe. But if you want to be saved, believe the gospel. Believe it enough to obey it, which includes dying to sin in repentance. And that's the hardest part of the plan of salvation for us. Repent, which means change your life. And then be buried with Christ in baptism and be raised to walk a new life. And so Baptism is God promising to do something for us when we show our faith in His gospel plan. Now look at what Jesus said in John chapter 3. We've looked at Matthew 3. Let's go to John 3. John 3, 3 through 5. A Pharisee named Nicodemus came to Jesus at night. And Jesus said to him, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." And so we ask the question, what did Jesus mean when he said, "Be born of the water and of the Spirit"? Some have said that the water here represents the Spirit. Now, if that's true, then why would Jesus say, "Be born of the Spirit and of the Spirit"? You know, that would be redundant and ridiculous. No, Jesus said what he meant, and he meant what he said. Others say, well, water refers to the physical birth, when a woman's water breaks when giving physical birth. However, physical birth is not a must for being born again. Physical birth has already occurred, obviously. People already physically born do not need to be told that they need to be physically born. Jesus himself also shows us that the Jewish term for physical birth was of the flesh, not of the water. It was of the flesh in John 3:6, the very next verse. If Jesus meant you must be physically born, in verse 5, he would have said, "Be born, you must be born of flesh, not of water." Also, the next time the word water appears in John chapter 3 is in verse 23, where John was baptizing in Enon near Salem because there was much water there. Water obviously referring to baptism throughout John chapter 3. You do not have to be a Bible scholar to figure this out. It is clear to any unbiased reader of the Bible. You must be born again by being baptized in water. This agrees perfectly with what Peter said on the day of Pentecost, the day the church began, in Acts 2:38, where water and spirit are connected in baptism. Peter said to them, "Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." So people are to be baptized in water to have their sins remitted or forgiven and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Why? Why do people need that? Because people don't need a little religion. They need regeneration. They need new life. They need to be reborn. They need a new start. The Bible teaches this recreation, this new birth, occurs in the water of baptism. 1 John 5 and verse 8 says, "There are three that bear witness on earth: the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one." This obviously is a reference to baptism, because only in baptism are you immersed in water to have the blood of Christ applied to your sin, and you receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So it should not surprise us that John and Peter agree with Jesus. Yeah, Peter and John were disciples of Jesus, and they spoke and they wrote under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that filled Jesus. But now let's go to a passage in the book of Acts that is often used to say you do not have to be baptized to be saved. It's in Acts 16. Paul and Silas were beaten. They were imprisoned for preaching the gospel of Christ. And at midnight, they're in prison. They're singing and they're praying to God. And an earthquake shakes the jail. The prison doors are opened. The Philippian jailer, thinking all the prisoners have escaped, was about to kill himself when Paul says, "Do yourself no harm, we're all here." And then the jailer called for a light and fell down before Paul and Silas and asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, Acts 16:31, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved and your household." And so many of our denominational friends will hang their hat on that verse and say, "See there? Acts 16:31 doesn't say anything about baptism. Just says, believe on Jesus, you'll be saved." Well, keep in mind, the jailer didn't even know who Jesus was. He'd never heard of him. And it is true that everyone must believe in Jesus to be saved. But the record of the conversion of the Philippian jailer and his family does not end in verse 31. That's only the beginning. We need to read the rest of the story and not take one scripture out of context. Again, you don't have to be a Bible scholar to understand that. And so let's read the next verses. 32 through 34, "They spoke unto him the word of the Lord, to him and to all who were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes. And immediately he and his family were baptized. Now when he brought them into his house, he set food before them, and he rejoiced, having believed in God with all his household." So what was the Philippian jailer told to believe? The word of the Lord about Jesus Christ, which obviously included baptism. The Philippian jailer and his family were told to believe in Jesus to be saved. Then he and his family are baptized. And then they rejoiced. Why? Because they believed in Jesus. Again, you don't have to be a Bible scholar to see this, that believing and being baptized go together in salvation. And so why is it then that so many who claim to be Bible scholars do not teach this? In fact, they write page after page in commentaries trying to explain baptism away. Why is that? And why is it that so many churches do not practice what the Bible teaches on this topic? Well, think about it. If the devil can confuse people about the gospel of Christ, if the devil can confuse people about God's plan of salvation, has he not accomplished his mission? If the devil can keep people away from the blood of Christ, he has accomplished his mission. And so who is behind all this confusion and all this false teaching about baptism? It is the devil. And he makes me mad. And he also makes me sad. He makes me sad. I'm very sad that so many people are so badly misinformed about what the Bible says on this vitally important topic. And so now let me share with you three more things that the New Testament says about baptism. First of all, baptism says the gospel is true. 1 Corinthians 15 says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel, which I preach to you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast to the word which I preach to you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures." So here we see the gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And baptism is directly linked to the gospel of Christ. It is clearly taught in Romans chapter 6, 3 through 5. "Do you not know that so many of us, as were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death? Therefore, we are buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so, we also should walk in newness of life. Bible baptism is directly linked to the gospel. Baptism won't let you forget the gospel. Every time somebody is baptized, the Bible way, for the Bible reason, the gospel is proclaimed all over again. And if you are like me, and most of you are in this regard, you and I would rather see a sermon than hear one any day. Especially one that reenacts the very gospel of our salvation. Baptism says the gospel's true. And secondly, baptism says salvation is free. Salvation is free because Jesus is our Savior. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Baptism does not contradict that scripture. Baptism endorses that scripture. Have you ever considered how passive a person is in baptism? Jesus is the worker in baptism. You are the receiver. Nothing is earned. Everything is given. Baptism is that act of faith that lays down in God's operating room and allows Him to cut the sin out of our life, something we could never do for ourselves or by ourselves. But He can do it. And after you are baptized, then you can do good works to grow in grace and knowledge and expand the kingdom of God on the earth, because God adds all the saved to His church, and He wants all of His people involved in His kingdom's work. And if we're truly saved, then we will want what He wants. We want what He wants. But then thirdly, baptism is the answer of a good conscience toward God. In 1 Peter 3, Peter is talking about the ark that Noah built, wherein few, that is, eight souls, were saved from the flood of water that covered the earth. And this water symbolizes baptism, which now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a good conscience toward God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If anyone has doubts about his or her baptism, it is best to go ahead and be baptized again, so that your conscience will be clear before God. If you have been baptized for the wrong reason, you can be baptized for the right reason today. The Bible clearly teaches that baptism is involved in our salvation. It is certainly not the only thing involved, but the Bible teaches that it must be involved in getting us into Jesus Christ. And a child can understand it. Glory to God. Galatians 3, 26 and 27. "You're all the sons of God through faith in Jesus Christ. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ." That's so beautiful. It's so powerful. Baptism puts us into Christ. Christ puts us into the church of Christ. He writes our name down in the Lamb's Book of Life. He saves us. He remits our sins. He gives us the Holy Spirit. He puts us on the road to glory. And He empowers us every day to live the life God has called us all to live. This is not the plan of any earthly man. This is God's plan. This is God's grace. And that is our only hope. Do you believe it? Sir. If you believe it, obey it. We invite you to obey it. We're going to stand and sing our invitation song. We invite you to come today. If you need to be baptized for the forgiveness of sins, you come while we're singing. Thank you.
come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come home. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can't heal. Lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home, you're not too far.
Appreciate our praise team leading our worship today, and our special music. It was great. Hope that you can come back for evening service tonight at 6 o'clock. Brother Bobby Jones will be preaching for us tonight. Keep in mind, we've got Hope food left over from this past Monday. If you know somebody who can use some extra food, we've got it downstairs here and out on the riverbank at the garage. So it's there for all who may need it. Anything else we need to announce this morning before we're dismissed? Oh, yeah, Dottie wants to mention about she's needing more baskets for the ministry of making baskets for those who have been hospitalized from our church.
I know we have a lot of new people that probably don't even know about this ministry, but for several years now, when one of our members has been hospitalized for 3 days, we make them a sunshine basket. And I can go out when I'm ready to make the baskets, get the fruit, the candy, the laundries, whatever. But the baskets are hard to come by. Now this one is for Virgin Stapleton. And I want y'all to see what we do. Now I need baskets this size or a little bigger. So if you have some laying around you don't know what to do with and you'd like to donate them to this ministry, I can put them to good use. And
some of you might have some leftover Easter baskets next Sunday that you can give to Dottie. So when you're shopping for an Easter basket this week, find a really big one, okay? Use it and then give it to your children, grandchildren, and give it to Dottie, okay? That'd be a good thing to do. Anything else we need to announce today? Okay. If not, I'd like to ask Brother Wayne Shepherd to lead us in our closing prayer.
Heavenly Father,